With the foreign exchange auction system that is being implemented by John Panunitsa Mangudla and the Reserve Bank of Zimbabwe, he has been in operation since June of 2020. Theoretically, a foreign exchange auction system, commonly known as the Dutch auction system, operates like any other market. And in a market, picture Mbare Musika. People bring goods from all over the country. Mutoko, they bring tomatoes. Mutare, they bring madumbe, and so forth. Low veld, they bring sugarcane and zimbe. So in a proper market, there is free supply. There is liberalized supply. Anyone with a commodity has a right to put and place that commodity in the market. Equally, buyers will come from all over and make purchases. Supply and demand will then determine the price. So during that season, to continue with my example, during the season where there are so many cabbages, so many tomatoes, the price is naturally low. During the high season, like now, when there are no tomatoes and cabbages, the price actually goes up. So price determination is a subject of supply and demand. That's the ideal. That's the ideal. But here in Zimbabwe, the Reserve Bank is operating a rigged auction rate that should be called a fixed exchange rate, a manipulated exchange rate. So what is happening with the auction system, the fraudulent auction system that John is implementing, is that only one supplier supplies his money, and that is the Reserve Bank. The Reserve Bank is the only body that is supplying money, and they supplied money since June of 2020. And the total that they've supplied to date as of this Tuesday is a total of $240 million. So when you don't have liberalized supply, when you don't have other actors coming on board, you can't call it an auction market. You can't call it an auction, because an auction presupposes free supply and free demand. So anyone can walk in with foreign currency. And by the way, there are huge exporters in Zimbabwe with huge, sitting on huge balances of foreign currencies. Your Zimplats, for instance, the Tangandas of this world, you know, who export tea product, macadamia nuts from their beautiful estates in the Eastern Highlands of Zimbabwe. Gold producers, for instance, and as you know, the price of gold is on an all-time high, above $2,000 in ounce. Agricultural products, tobacco, you know, for instance, 90% of the tobacco that is produced is sold to outside on the tobacco auction floor. And by the way, that is the best example of an auction in Zimbabwe, because over 100,000 producers feed the tobacco auction floor, and more than 1 million buyers from all over the world come to Zimbabwe to purchase tobacco. But with the auction system that the RBZ, only one supplier is supplying, the Reserve Bank. Why are the other producers of foreign currency not actors on the auction floor? And remember, our exports are quite huge. Our exports are in excess of $4 billion. Yeah. So there are many companies who are exporting goods and services that ought to be participating. Mm-hmm. So once there is one supplier, that supplier now determines the price.
Yes.
That supplier now determines the price, because it's one source. There's no competition. So if I'm the only supplier in the market, I determine the price. And that is exactly what the Reserve Bank has been doing. It has been determining the price. And so now look, at the price from June to now, the price has been around an average price of 81.
Yes.
The rate has hardly moved from 79 to 81. Now, that's clearly rigged. That's clearly manipulated. If you look at the movement of currencies in economies that are stronger than Zimbabwe, take the rand, for instance. Take the Kenyan, shilling. Take the Ghanaian cedi. Take the British pound. Take the euro. Take the US dollar itself. Over the same period of time, June to end September of 2020, it has had, all these currencies have had a greater fluctuation, a greater movement than our own currency, which is backed by a weaker economy, which points to one thing and one thing alone. This is a rigged auction system. They shouldn't call it an auction system. It's just a fixed exchange. John just wakes up one morning. If his bed is on the right hand side, you will say 79 cents. If his bed is on the left hand side, you will say 81 cents. If his head is on the middle, you will say 83 cents. It's a rigged auction system. It's a fiction and everything, and it's not sustainable.
Can elaborate on that point.
It's not sustainable for three reasons. Firstly, the Reserve Bank can't continue pumping money into the system. Right now, we know for a fact that they've borrowed a huge amount of money from the African Import and Export Bank, the Afrexim Bank, illegally. And when I say illegally, they've not followed the provisions of Section 327 of the Constitution of Zimbabwe. They've not gone to Parliament to seek approval of that loan. So we know that the Afrexim Bank has been supplying money, but you can't run a national program on debt. It doesn't work. It's not sustainable. The only thing that was sustainable is to have a proper auction system where exporters would go on the market and sell their currency with the Reserve Bank being the regulator. Here you've got the Reserve Bank, which, as you know, in terms of the Reserve Bank Act, is a regulator. It regulates the banking system. It regulates foreign exchange in Zimbabwe. But you have the regulator being the player. So you've got a problem. You've got a problem there. Someone must guard the guard, and no one is guarding the guard here. So the Reserve Bank must just create an auction and let buyers and sellers of foreign currencies come into the market. But ultimately, what is sustainable in this country is not to play around and to joke around with our own local currency. It doesn't work, it won't work. Let's just go back to the regime of multiple currencies. It worked before, en route eventually to a situation where Zimbabwe can use the South African rand and we join the Rand Monetary Union. That is what is sustainable in the long term. So the first thing, it won't work because the Reserve Bank does not have seas of money, and it can't keep on borrowing from the Afrexim bank. Zimbabwe is already overexposed to the Afrexim bank. Two-thirds of the Afrexim bank balance sheet has been lent to Zimbabwe. That's irresponsible. That's not in accordance with sound corporate governance. It's a risk and it's dangerous. You can't lend your balance sheet to one person. That's dangerous. But the Afrexim bank is doing that. So that's number one. Number two, if $240 million has been released between June, July, September, October, 4 months, that's nothing compared to the country's demands. In that period alone, we probably have spent on imports more than $2 billion. We've spent on fuel, we have spent on food, we have spent on drugs, we have spent on electricity, we have spent on other things that are hidden, but that are so important to people. I run this law firm, I use ink cartridges. They are important. So across the length and breadth of Zimbabwe, in the 4 months from June to now, we probably have spent over in excess of $2 billion. Yet the auction system has released $240 million. What does that mean? It means that there's a market there, out there. The real market is actually out there, which is irrespective of the auction system. So the auction is a myth that is affecting less than 10% of businesses in Zimbabwe. 90% of businesses are not dealing and are not getting their foreign currency from the auction system. Where they are they getting it? Number one, they're getting it offshore. Companies trading directly, one-on-one daily body, dealing with the Zimplats and so forth. Two, they're getting their market, their foreign exchange from the parallel market. So as long as you've got an unfree, rigged foreign exchange, the black market will always be there. And the black market is there. The black market right now is around 105, 110. And if you do the averages between June to October of 2020, if you compare the official exchange rate and the parallel market exchange rate, the difference has been around 30%. The difference has been around 30%. So the auction rate is a distortion. It's overpriced by a factor of 30%. So companies with money can't go to a rigged auction where they're going to sell their product, the US dollar, at 80 cents when they can sell it 105 at 110. They will not accept this overpriced exchange rate of US 1:8. That's why the parallel market is alive and kicking. The third thing that will make the auction rate not sustainable are what are called grey imports. Grey imports. Grey imports are imports that are made outside the system, outside the central bank, by people dealing directly and avoiding formal sources of interaction. So if you go to 4th Street right now, you will see literally hundreds of buses and trucks bringing goods through Malaysians from South Africa. Those are grey imports, and they bring everything, refrigerators, vehicles, etc., outside the system. Diaspora remittances as well. People overseas now, if you stay in Australia and you've got your own mother in Chendambuye or Lotito, you simply buy groceries direct from South Africa. From here, there are now local companies, and the money doesn't leave offshore. Money is not coming here, but goods are coming here. So grey imports are increasing. Grey imports are increasing, and which means that the volumes of foreign currency operating outside the system, operating outside the banking system, operating outside the auction system are huge. Which brings me to the fourth point, that we now have an informal cash US dollar economy that is existing in this country. An informal cash US dollar economy that is existing in this country, which is unregulated. Then number two, we've got a formal US dollar economy. We've got a formal US dollar economy. You can go to ZESA and pay US dollars. You can go to Pick n Pay and pay US dollars. That's formal. You pay some taxes, for instance, to buy a license plate, you pay US dollars. So you've got a formal US dollar economy. Then you've got a formal Zim dollar economy. You've got a formal Zim dollar economy. Now here's the problem. All the data and the statistics in this country, inflation figures, etc., they are measured in the formal Zim dollar economy.
Sure.
But that's not the true story.
Yes.
That's not the true story, because people are transacting in US dollars, formally and informally. Formally and informally. So what it means is that there is so much arbitrage around the economy. There's so much distortion around the economy, because there are three economies that are existing. The one that is operating in the Zim dollar economy, the formal Zim dollar economy, has got other sub-levels. There's a sub-level of eco cash. There's a sub-level of people who actually deal with cash. There's a sub-level of RRTGS. All those things have got different implications, different values, and so forth. So if you want to buy a grocery in RRTGS, it has got a different price from cash. Zim dollar cash, yes. Different price. Yes. From eco cash, different price. Yes. So it's a totally distorted economy. It can't work, it won't work. The solution is go to one monocurrency, the regime of multiple currencies, en route to joining the Rand Monetary Union and introducing the South African Rand.
Oh, okay. Thank you, Master.
Again, it's still the Reserve Bank supplying the money. It's because no one will go and sell money at an auction where you're getting 1:80 when you can get 1:110 or 1:15 on the parallel market. Or when we can just deal directly with a person who'll give you money at 100 or 105 and so forth. As I said before, the difference between the official exchange rate, the auction rate, and the parallel market rate has been a premium of around 30%. So the formal auction rate is overvalued by 30%. So, and here's another distortion. Here's another distortion why people will avoid the auction. Because people are now crying. Because what happens is that if you go in a supermarket, the supermarket will sell goods very expensively on prices, using prices that are already indexed at the black market rate. So if you buy a packet of rice, if you buy a packet of meat is around $900 a packet. So that's like $9. So that's a black market rate. If you produce your $100 now, the supermarket is going to discount that at 1:80, not 1:100. So you're now losing twice. Because you've bought that $100, you're going to spend at 1:105. But it's now going to be discounted against you in a supermarket at 1:80. Which again means that as long as these distortions are there, the parallel market will always be there. Now, what would that person do now? That person who has got $100, who is now told that if you go to Pick and Pay, who is now told that, well, no, your $100 here is not worth a 1,000 bond notes, it's worth 800. He or she will gather his friends and they will send and hire a Malaysia to bring things from macro, from game in South Africa. And that is why you have seen a sharp increase in grey imports in Malaysias. You are investigative journalist. I ask you to actually go to Fort Street and see the huge volumes that Malaysias are bringing into the country, which is a reflection of the distortion of monetary policy, the failure of monetary policy.
Okay. USD.
Yeah, you see, only a government that steals wants controls.
Yes.
Yeah, you see, because they steal foreign currency, they want controls. What is stopping them from just liberalizing? What is stopping them from just allowing things as they were? You know, you have your Zim dollar if you like, but allow people to operate freely in banks using the regime of multiple currencies. And why do you need to take export surrender requirements? Why do you need to take the monies of Zimplus, the monies of Tanganda, the monies of every exporter in the country, the monies of poor tobacco farmers?
Yes.
Why do you need to create, why does the government need to have a fingerprint and a huge footprint in the economy? It only happens because this is a government of bandits, this is a government of criminals, this is a government of that is extractive, and there's no respect to basic laws of economics. And that's why we are in this war. You know, this regime insults the people of Zimbabwe. Any person, any mother, any woman, any person who walks into a supermarket knows that there's carnage there. You can hardly buy anything with less than 15,000 bond notes, which is $150. So there's a carnage there because there's an economy that is operating out there. And that economy is the US dollar. All those prices you see in supermarkets are actually expressed in US dollars. And because these retailers are now allowed to charge in US dollars, there's no supply. Thank God every good you want now, every commodity you want is actually now there, because the retailers are now having a decent return, which is US dollars. So I go back to what I said at the beginning, that there's a distortion. We've got a proper US dollar economy. Then we've got an informal US dollar cash economy. Then we've got a formal US dollar economy. Then we've got a Zim dollar economy. So even in the real US dollar terms, the cash US dollar economy, every mother, every woman will tell you that the price of basic commodities have gone up and is increasing. That's why If you look at the Consumer Council of Zimbabwe, if you look at the figures being produced by the Zimbabwe Congress of Trade Unions, the basket, the poverty datum line right now is now around 25,000 for a family of six. And 25,000, that's 250 US dollars. That's a lot of money. But ironically, people are earning, teachers are earning $30. Teachers are earning 20 US dollars. So the cost of living has gone up. People are starving. The poverty rates are increasing. 79% of our people right now are living in extreme poverty, surviving on less than US $1.35 a day. If you doubt that, go to Lotito, go to Chendapuya, go to Highfield, go to Mbare, go to Epworth, go to Pelandaba, go to Magwegwe. People are suffering. Go to Makokova. People are suffering. The price of goods is haywire. And it's out of control. It's out of control. The poverty datum line basket is now around 25,000. But who earns 25,000?